Welcome to the Postgraduate Educational Webinar Series. My name is Dr. Shilpa Joshi and I'm going to speak on DSEK, Desmet Stripping Endothelial Keratoplasty.
Dr. Shilpa Joshi is a senior cornea surgeon and head of the Department of Cornea and director of one of the largest eye banks in Maharashtra. She is expert in performing several complicated corneal surgeries, and she is also an excellent trainer, and she has several publications to her credit.
Thank you, Dr. Suchita, for those kind words. So this is a talk on endothelial keratoplasty and more specifically DSEC. The technique of keratoplasty has evolved in a major way, especially in the last two decades. Constant pursuit by surgeons to improve outcomes and utilization of available donor tissue has resulted in some revolutionary changes. These new techniques allow the cornea surgeons to transplant selectively diseased affected layers of the cornea. So there is this revolutionary concept of component cornea surgery, by which we mean that there is no need to transplant the full thickness of the cornea in a patient, depending upon the disease conditions or the conditions affecting the layers of the cornea, we can selectively transplant the layers. For example, superficial anterior lamellar keratoplasty or SALC, in which the anterior 150 to 100 to 150 microns of the epithelium, Bowman's membrane and stroma are transplanted. Deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty, in which the stroma up to the Desmet's membrane is dissected from the recipient, and that much layer of the anterior tissue is transplanted. DSEK or Desmet's stripping endothelial keratoplasty, in which the posterior stroma, the Desmet's membrane and the endothelium is transplanted. And the newest surgery, DMEK or Desmet's membrane endothelial keratoplasty, in which only the Desmet's membrane and the endothelium complex is transplanted. So this is in short overview of the lamellar keratoplasty, the anterior lamellar and the posterior lamellar. Anterior lamellar can be further divided into various categories like SALC, MALC, ALTK, DALK, etc. And posterior lamellar into DSEC or DSAEK and DMEC. Coming to DSEC or DSAEK, this technique combines stripping of the dysfunctional endothelium from the host cornea with micro dissection of the donor cornea. Patient's endothelium is replaced with a transplanted disc of posterior stroma, Desmet's membrane and endothelium. This reduces all the open globe related and ocular surface related complications of a full thickness penetrating keratoplasty. So the basic question, why there is need for endothelial keratoplasty? The most important reasons are that the catastrophic complications of PK, namely the expulsive hemorrhage and suprachoroidal hemorrhage, the risk of these is minimized in a EK. Also, the chance of post-traumatic graft dehiscence leading to loss of the eye and loss of vision is very minimal in EK because of the stable globe configuration. There are no sutures, no alteration of the anterior corneal surface and no astigmatism, faster wound healing, no suture-related complications, earlier and better visual rehabilitation, improved visual outcomes. Again, one of the most important reasons is less chance of graft rejection. Selective transplantation of the posterior layer is done in these surgeries. So much less amount of tissue is transplanted, which reduces the risk of rejection compared to a full thickness graft. Less incidence of secondary glaucoma. Ocular surface topography and sensations are preserved, so less incidence of surface problems. Less endothelial cell attrition rate in post-op period, and long-term survival of the grafts is much better. So coming to indications of DSEC, all the endothelial dystrophies like Fuchs dystrophy, posterior polymorphous dystrophy, iridocorneal endothelial syndromes are the main indications. Also, pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, aphakic bullous keratopathy, post-cataract surgery. are the main indications. Pseudophagic bullous keratopathy can present as a spectrum from pseudophagic corneal edema to full thickness corneal decompensation. Another important indication in our country or our kind of setups is previous failed grafts, namely previous failed therapeutic and optical grafts, where if you go to do a full optical penetrating graft again, then there is a need of systemic immunosuppression, which has been totally abolished because of the newer DSEC surgery. Also, post-infectious herpetic endothelitis, corneal decompensation secondary to glaucoma or filtering surgeries, VR surgeries, are the indications, and the indications have been further extended to include congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy, aniridia, and diophthalmos. So there is a definite learning curve for DSEC. Just as from ECC to FACO is a big learning curve. Similarly, from PK to DSEC is also a learning curve. The techniques of these two surgeries are completely different, and specialized skill set, instrumentation, and everything is required for the DSEC surgery. These are the instruments required. This is the artificial anterior chamber on which the donor tissue is mounted for dissection. These are the lamellar dissectors, the straight and the curved ones, which are used for the dissection of the donor tissue. This is the reverse Sinsky hook and the endothelial scraper, which are used for the scoring of the Descemet's membrane from the patient. And this is the mucin glide. This or a variety of endoglides are used to insert the dissected donor lenticule. Coming to detailed step-by-step description of the surgery, mainly manual dissection, DSEC. So two clear corneal limbal stab incisions are placed about 5 clock hours apart to be used as access point to anterior chamber later in the operation. Through one of the stab incisions, a cohesive viscoelastic elon is placed into the anterior chamber to replace the aqueous fully. Dispersive viscoelastics should be avoided because it can cause interface coating with subsequent non-adherence and dislocation of the donor tissue, an important point to be remembered. Circular mark width refine of diameter 8, 8.5 or 9, depending upon the recipient corneal diameter and the surgeon preference, is made on the central epithelial surface. This circular mark will be used as a template for stripping of the recipient Descemet's membrane. A blunt tip reverse Sinsky hook is passed through the limbal incision and diseased endothelium with DM is punctured. A circular groove is made first all along 360 degrees and then with gentle peeling movements, 360 degree peeling of the Descemet's membrane from the overlying stroma is done. Peripheral scraping of the recipient bed is accomplished with the use of a broad and blunt tip scraper. As we discussed previously, it is necessary to roughen the periphery so as to cut the stromal fibrils of the recipient bed, because this significantly contributes to the donor lenticule adhesion. So this is a photograph showing the scoring of the Descemet's. Now coming to donor preparation, in many cases donor tissue is prepared first, especially when there are clean cases like pseudophagic corneal edema or cases like Fuchs dystrophy. The donor tissue is prepared first, so that once the patient is on the table, that much time is saved. On the other hand, if there is a case of PBK, but with anterior surface and scarring, vascularization, etc., or cases where you are not sure that the desmatorexis will be possible, then in those cases, the recipient bed is prepared first and the donor is prepared later on. So the donor is mounted on the artificial anterior chamber with endothelial side down and largest diameter in horizontal meridian, with one port of the chamber connected to saline bottle and other to a 5cc syringe containing air. Pressure in the AC always needs to be maintained on the higher side. Dissection is done either under saline or air. Peripheral incision is made with guarded depth diamond knife set at 350 microns dissection is started with a crescent blade and continued with both lamellar dissectors towards opposite clypeus 360 degrees around. It is important to maintain the pressure in the chamber to avoid anterior and or posterior puncture and dissection in one plane to create a smooth interface between anterior and posterior layers is necessary. While dismounting the tissue, the seal needs to be broken first and then the assembly of the AAC is taken out to minimize the endothelial cell loss. So coming to the various donor insertion techniques, usually a scleral tunnel incision 4 to 6 mm in length is made. All the visco is removed from the AC and for the further steps are carried out under either saline or air. The dissected donor is kept on the Teflon block. Single layer of visco is put on it and refine of the same size as used for the template for the recipient dissection or recipient desmatorexis is used. So important to remember here that the donor and the recipient size of the graft is same, unlike a PK. So the initial technique in donor insertion was called TACO fold. In this, one edge of the posterior donor lenticule is grasped with special insertion forceps. Tissue is folded in a 60-40 TACO with anterior stromal side 60%, posterior stromal side 40% with endothelium protected in between. The folded tissue is inserted into the AC in one deft movement by inserting the donor with the anterior 60% stromal side facing the recipient bed and the posterior fold or the posterior TACO facing the iris. Saline is gently injected so that the TACO begins to open up and then air bubble is injected from the left paracentesis until the tissue opens up completely. Asymmetric folding of the tissue ensures that it opens in correct orientation. If needed, the donor lenticule is centered with reverse Sinsky hook, grasping the peripheral edge of the tissue and pulling it to the center. Then there is a period of 10 minutes of light out with full chamber air bubble with stroking of the epithelial surface to remove the interface fluid. Some surgeons also advocate venting incisions, which is a maneuver for interface fluid removal. This involves placing the stab incisions from surface to the interface in the peripheral part or mid-peripheral cornea in each quadrant. Donor tissue to fully warm up to body temperature and endothelial pump function to begin takes this 10 minutes of time. This also allows the full cohesive interaction of the peripheral recipient and donor interface stromal fibril so that the donor lenticule adheres fully to the recipient bed. So till that time, all the other steps such as suturing of the incision, venting incisions or stroking of the epithelial surface to remove the interface fluid are done. Double ring sign is a very important sign which indicates the correct orientation of the tissue. So the inner ring, which is the reflection from the stroma, should appear closer to the surface, whereas the outer ring should appear, which is a reflection from the endothelium, should appear deeper. At the end, mediatic drops are put to avoid papillary block glaucoma. The wound is sutured and saline is gently injected to reduce the size of the air bubble. Another modification in the donor insertion is the pull-through technique, which was described by Dr. Naskai and Tara Jose, in which 10-0 proline suture is passed through. This is a suture pull-through technique. In this, a 10-0 proline suture is passed through 5 mm superior lamellar incision and across the AC to exit through the cornea approximately 1 mm beyond the edge of the strict desmates. The donor endothelium is coated with small amount of visco and second arm of the suture is passed through the periphery of donor lenticule, entering from the endothelial side and exiting from the stromal side. It is then passed through the incision across the AC through the cornea 1 mm central to the edge of the strict DA. The donor lenticule is folded in half with the suture at the leading edge and anterior edge of the incision is lifted as both ends of the suture are pulled to guide the graft into the eye. The graft unfolds as the AC is filled with air and it is secured by tying of the suture, which helps to minimize the risk of graft dislocation. So this is a paper published in American Journal of Ophthalm, which compares the two techniques, suture assisted versus forceps assisted technique. And in this, so they came to the conclusion suture assisted dissect was a valid alternative to forceps insertion. However, it does not seem to offer any significant advantage. Then another pull through technique described by Dr. Buesing is using the Buesing glide, which is a funnel glide which curls the graft into a cylindrical shape. So the graft is pulled into the eye with micro forceps that are introduced through a stab incision directly across the main incision. The advantages of this are it avoids folding of the graft, which seems to reduce the endothelial cell loss. Folding and unfolding of the graft is not required, so it is relatively easy to maintain the correct endothelial side down orientation. It allows the surgeon to maintain a secure grip on the graft until it is well positioned. But since it's a bimanual technique, it is technically difficult. So this is again a paper comparing the technique of Buesing glide versus forceps insertion. Forceps for the insertion of donor lenticule. And in this series, they found that the endothelial cell loss was significantly lower in the Buesing guide assisted dissect compared to the forceps assisted. So nowadays, most of the surgeons are following this glide assisted techniques for dissect instead of the tacofold. So these are the, this is the TAN endoglide, this is the endoserter, this is the endosever, and this is the dissect forceps, which is required with all these dissect in difficult situations. As we discussed in the previous slide, shallow AC or small eyes, especially Asian or Indian eyes with less axial length, is a difficult situation because there is a lot of positive vitreous pressure during the surgery, making the pull-through technique difficult. So as a contingency technique, the push-in technique, forceps insertion or sheet slide insertion with 30 gauge needle is helpful in these situations. So in all of these dissect surgeries, one should be mastering the one of those pull-through techniques, either the suture pull-through or the Buesing glide or the various endoglide technique. And the tacofold or forceps insertion technique should be kept as a standby for certain situations. So in short, you need to be the jack of all trades and master of one technique. Another difficult situation is glaucomatous eyes with which trab has been done with large bleds or tube shunts or glaucoma drainage devices or large iridectomies are there. These eyes are too hypotonous. So there is a higher chance of graft dislocation in the post-op period. And there is a risk of movement of the air bubble out of the eye into the subconjunctival space or into the tube of the drainage device. Aphakia is also a difficult situation. With the absence of AC and a large central PCR, there is a chance of air bubble escaping to the vitreous cavity. If iris diaphragm is not intact and there is partial or near total aniridia, then there is a suboptimal air tamponade and there is a high risk of graft dislocation even in the vitreous cavity. To place an IOL is recommended in this situation because it will provide a scaffold for the air tamponade. So the preferred IOLs are transscleral sutured IOLs or intrascleral haptic fixated IOLs. If the iris diaphragm is intact, then posterior fixated iris claw lenses also do equally well. So this is a case operated at our hospital. This was a PBK with the PCIOL placed in the AC. And a dissect with the IOL explant with iris claw was done. And this is the post-op picture. Subluxated IOLs with vitreous in the AC is another difficult situation. So anterior vitrectomy is done, and then the stability of the IOL is decided, and then the decision whether to if the same IOL or to explant and put another one is taken. ACIOLs, if they are well placed, the anterior chamber depth is more than 3 millimeters, then there is no need to exchange them. Then there are situations in which there is epithelial scarring with vascularization. In this case, superficial keratectomy is done at the beginning step of DSEC. And at the end of the surgery, an AMG can be placed over the corneal surface to promote epithelial healing. More difficult are the ones with severe stromal haze or stromal scarring. So these make the view often pure and very often poor. And there is an intraop difficulty in right from the DM scoring to the putting of the graft donor lenticule inside. And that's why this makes the surgery very, very difficult. There can be several intraop complications. For example, perforation during donor dissection. Anterior puncture is more common and it's a lesser hazard. But posterior DM puncture can even mean a loss of tissue. There can be irregular plane of dissection, so irregular thickness of the donor lenticule, which will affect the final visual acuity. There can be difficulty in unfolding the graft. Unfolding with a reverse orientation can occur. There can be excessive handling during the entire surgery, especially during the unfolding centration or air fluid exchange. So graft dislocation, as we have been discussing, is the most frequent early post-op complications after EK, particularly in with novice surgeons. So reported dislocation rates have varying from 0 to 82% with average rate of 15%. Usually graft dislocation is detected on the first or second post-op day, but occasionally it may occur several weeks later also. So causes are full thickness graft edge from a decentered trephination or surgical trauma that temporarily or permanently reduces the endothelial cell function, or hypotony, post-trab eyes, or there can be a wound leading to inadequate tamponade, leading to early absorption of the air bubble and dislocation of the graft. There could be interface fluid. So stoking of the corneal surface to squeeze out the fluid is very important step. The role of venting incisions as a routine is questionable according to many surgeons. Postoperative excessive rubbing or squeezing of the eye can also lead to graft dislocation. So management is, if there is a total dislocation, then rebubbling or air injection, full chamber air injection is advised along with stoking of the surface and venting incisions. So this paper again is a large series of DSEC, which says that graft dislocation is the most common complication of DSEC surgery, with the incidence in their series was 20 to 25%. 68 of these detachments, they required rebubbling, and there was a graft failure rate after rebubbling or repositioning in the range of 4%. IOP elevation is another common complication. So the air bubble can cause capillary block in the immediate post-op period. Incidence is around 10%. Delayed IOP elevation is one of the other frequent complications, usually noticed in the first year after EK. Causes could be inflammation or steroid use. Incidence of raised IOP in DSEC has been found to be 15 to 30%. There is more propensity for this complication with in eyes with pre-existing glaucoma. So in those cases, surgical procedure may be necessary. Whereas in eyes without pre-existing glaucoma, medical management by initiating or increasing the glaucoma medications or reducing the topical steroids is the treatment. Graft rejection in EK. Signs are presence of KPs, diffuse corneal edema, endothelial rejection line, but no epithelial line or subepithelial infiltrates like a PK. The incidence is obviously lower than the PK because lesser amount of tissue is transplanted. Now again, this is a large series published in Cornea in which they found that the rejection episodes were less frequent after EK than PK. 15, that is 7.5% of EK cases, a rejection episode was noticed in the first 2 years after surgery, compared to 92 or 30%, 13% of the PK cases. Graft failure after rejection occurred only in one case of EK, whereas it occurred in 26 cases in PK. So the risk of graft rejection was not increased in patients whose fellow eye received EK within another year. So that is one more advantage of EK surgery, that unlike PK, one need not wait for 1 year for the other eye to get operated. Endothelial cell loss. Early endothelial cell loss is typically higher in EK than PK because of the excessive extra donor tissue manipulation. 1 year after EK, the endothelial cell loss is usually 30 to 40% compared with the 12-month cell loss of about 20% in PK. But after the 6 months, the rate of subsequent cell loss is comparatively low in EK, 1 to 4% only, relative to the continued high cell loss, which is in the range of 10 to 12% throughout the 5 years in PK. Infectious keratitis has been reported with D6. So all types, bacterial, fungal, herpetic, all have been reported. The most common isolate is Candida, which is mostly from the donor tissue. Usually we find the infiltrate, which is deep-seated, either at the donor lenticule or at the interface. Topical antifungals are not very effective in this scenario, and removal of the lenticule with therapeutic PK is what is needed for management. Interface haze may be because of the blood retained visco or irregularly dissected donor button or irregular cut by microkeratome or retained DM fragments. Reflections from irregular interface is a major cause of glare, halos, and reduced vision post-op. Primary graft failure is when the graft does not clear by 2 months after surgery. Causes could be poor surgical technique, poor quality of donor tissue, unhealthy recipient circumstances. Published study shows rates of primary graft failure between 0 and 29%. There is a post-op hyperopia or shift of 0.75 to 1.5 diopters in all the DSEC cases. Depends on the thickness of the lenticule. This thing should be kept in mind while doing a combined DSEC with cataract, for example, in a Fuchs dystrophy case. So one should keep a target myopia of 1 diopter in mind while calculating the IOL power. Endophthalmitis, ocular surface problems, and higher order aberrations have also been noted in the DSEC surgery. Coming to ultra thin DSEC. So when the thickness of the donor lenticule is less than 100 microns, it is called ultra thin DSEC. The advantages are faster visual recovery, predictable or reproducible results, even in difficult situations, for example, very hazy corneas with poor visibility, and reduced chances of graft rejection compared to a routine DSEC. So it is done either by a single pass technique in which 400 microns of micron of tissue of the microkeratome head with slowing speed of the pass to achieve a thin donor lenticule without any complication during donor preparation. And the mean graft thickness achieved usually is around 111 microns. Or there is a double pass technique in which initial debulking cut is performed using a microkeratome with 300 micron head, and a second refinement cut is carried out from opposite direction to the first cut. Manual dissection DSEC can also be done by using this double pass technique. So these are some of our post-op cases. This is a DSEC done for iridocorneal endothelial syndrome. You can see that iris stromal atrophy in this patient. This is a post-operative 1 month old photo. This was one of the earlier DSECs done for Fuchs dystrophy case, and this graft is clear and surviving for the last 8 years. This is a bilateral DSEC the other eye, left eye, was done within 6 months of the first surgery. This is a defect done in the congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy in a child. This is a defect done in a very hazy cornea where the visualization was extremely difficult because of the extreme surface scarring as well as the stromal scarring. End defect is another variation in the technique where it is usually done in cases like previous failed graft, for example, previous failed therapeutic or optical graft. So here the scoring of the Descemet's membrane is not done because in a previous prior PK case, the graft post junction never really heals. So there is a chance of dehiscence if you attempt to do a DM stripping in this case. So just a posterior donor lenticule is prepared and it is placed by the usual scleral tunnel incision in these cases. So this is an example of a failed therapeutic PK in which end defect was done and postoperatively the patient is doing very well. So this is a video of the manual dissection defect. This was a particularly hazy cornea with very poor visibility. This was because of the deep stromal haze, surface scarring as well as the stromal haze. So initially, a circular mark is made with being made with an 8 mm trephine. This mark is going to serve as a template for the desmatorexis. To improve the visualization, epithelial debridement is done so that there is at least some view of the Descemet's and the AC. Now this is a reverse Sinsky hook which is used to make a circular groove. First, puncture the endothelium and make a circular groove all around the template mark. And then with a peeling movement, the Descemet is scored all 360 degrees. It's important to remove each and every remnant of this Descemet. Otherwise, the donor lenticular adhesion is not going to be proper. There can be a dislocation in the post-op period, or in the late post-op period, there could be interface irregularities affecting the visual outcome. So here in this case, because there was a lot of stromal scarring and adhesions between the DM and the overlying posterior stroma, this micro scissors was used to dissect the DM from the stroma. And in that bargain, some of the stromal fibrils, posterior stromal fibrils, were also cut. So again, roughening of the posterior surface is after the scoring of the Descemet's is an important step, which again is very effective for the proper adhesion of the donor tissue. Now this is preparation of the donor using the artificial anterior chamber. So initial mark is made with a side port knife, and then the dissection is begun with a crescent blade. Important to maintain the same plane of dissection and not to cause anterior or posterior puncture. The further dissection is carried out using the straight and the curved lamellar dissectors. It is important to create a smooth, regular pocket at the desired stromal depth from one side of the limbus to the other side and all along 360 degrees. Then a scleral tunnel of about 6 mm is made in the post in the usual way. Two paracentesis are made on the right and left side, and a third one is made at the opposite 6 o'clock. This is the donor tissue which is has been dissected completely, and the posterior cap is taken on this Buccin glide, and the dissect forceps are introduced from the opposite end, and this tissue kept in the mucin glide is being pulled across the AC in a single stroke. So after that, saline is injected to unfold the tissue completely, and then air is injected. And this air bubble is kept for about 10 minutes to allow adhesions. So this is about the indications and various techniques of BSEC surgery. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.